standard deviation. You've heard those terms, but today we might be talking about some terms that are new to you, like skewness and kurtosis. And then we're going to really hammer home that correlation does not imply causation. You may have heard that before. We're going to beat that drum loudly today. Okay. So let's get into it. This is the cocaine data that we've been talking about. And I'm using the Minitab graphs today. Again, Minitab is optional for you. I think they're really useful. You can see that we have a lot to talk about with each one of these little graphical summaries. Excel can calculate all of these values, but Minitab does it in just a couple of menu clicks. So you have your data, you go in, you say graphical summary of the data, tell it what column you want a summary of, and in this case it's the trainee, and it gives you all of this information about those 10 data points. And so you're about three clicks away from all of this information. Whereas you're doing it by hand in Excel, you have to type in the formula for the mean and the standard deviation and the F-test and T-test and all those different things. Notice that you have the data in the histogram format, and then you have this Gaussian curve overlaid on it. If there are no trends in the data, and it's just normally distributed, and you had enough data points so that you could actually capture the trend in the, or the distribution of the data, if there are no external trends or special causes, it should be randomly distributed. It should be a normal distribution. And so there's this Anderson-Darling normality test, and this p-value is telling you if the data is normally distributed. And so we would look at that and see, okay, that's the probability that it is normally distributed. Remember, anytime you see a p-value, you need to know what the null hypothesis is. And so it's implied in the name of the test, the Anderson-Darling normality test. So it's testing for normality. And so that's telling you something about what the null hypothesis is, and then you have that p-value. And so if you don't understand something like this test in Minitab, then use the help menu. Minitab is a really good statistics guide. In fact, that's another reason to try to explore it. And if you can't get to it on the at the university computer lab, for many, many years, maybe it's still going on, Minitab would let you download a free full version and use it for like 3 to 6 months. Well, you know, this whole class only takes less than 3 months. So you could have your own personal version for free for a trial period. And just that stat guide is really helpful for learning statistical terms. And so then it's going to tell you about this normality test. And so this is the null hypothesis for the Anderson-Darling normality test. The data follow a normal distribution. So that's what you would assume if you said if this is a normality test, it's testing if the data is normal. Okay, but still the probability, the p-value is telling you what the probability of that null hypothesis being true is. And so the p-value is that probability of HO being true. If the probability is less than 0.05, then reject it. So let's go back and see. It's 0.196. So it's saying it's 19% chance, really 20% chance of it being normal. That doesn't sound great, but we would reject it at less than 5 or less. Okay. So we're okay with this. We would say with 10 data points, we can't really say it's not normally distributed. Okay. So here is for the forensic chemist. And so all of the data, it looks like a worse distribution, but it's all very tightly collected. And the normality test is 0.017, so it's much less than 0.05. So we're saying, yeah, it's not normally distributed. That's because we got, you know, four of the same exact result, three of the same exact result, and then we had these three trailing over here. We see that there's a statistical term related to this kind of spread. Does anybody know what that statistical term is? It's not normally distributed, but what is a term that would describe something that looks like this? Skew? Yeah, exactly. So skewness is the term for this. You see, all the data points are over here on this side, and then they trail off to the right. And skewness tells you which way it trails. So it's trailing to the right, and that's so it's skewed to the right. For some reason, people get right and left all confused on this, you know. And I think it's because they think, where's most of the data? Most of the data is over here on this side, but it trails off. It tapers off. not a symmetric triangle. A triangle has got a long edge over here on the right. And then you come over here and look at this skew value, and you see it's greater than 1, so that's tailing to high numbers. And so right and left might be confusing if you have the data plotted with the axis inverted. Okay, and so you want to look to see, instead of right and left, look at it and say to high values or low values. So this is skewing to high values. See, 13.1 is over here on the left, 13.7 is over here on the right. So it's skewed high, and that's greater than 1 over here in the skewness value. So for the trainee, notice how you have a lot of data points that just one, and then over here, just one data point here. And then in the middle, you have 3 and 3. So it's flat, almost flat, and you've got these two peaks in the middle. Okay, so it's very peaked data. There's a term for that. It's not skewness. That's the kurtosis term. Sounds like halitosis, bad breath. It's kurtosis. So this kurtosis value, if it's greater than 1, it's going to be peaked. If less than 1, it's going to be very, very flat, boxy-looking data. We'll see examples of that from the Minitab stat book. So here's the kurtosis value. Actually, it goes positive and negative. So positive means it's sharply peaked, and negative means it's flat peaked. So notice how the data is kind of spread out, and then it drops to 0 very quickly. Both of these occur when you have multiple distributions on top of each other. So a positive kurtosis can come from what we call bimodal data with the same mean. So you have two data sets with the same mean, but different standard deviations. You see them? See this really wide standard deviation with the mean right here in the middle, and then this one with the narrow standard deviation with the mean right in the middle. They overlap on top of each other. And if they're in the same data set, you're trying to see if this overall shape is a Gaussian. It's not a Gaussian. It's really two Gaussians on top of each other that have the same mean but different standard deviations. So that would give you a positive kurtosis value. What about this negative kurtosis value? You can get one of those if you have multiple distributions. So multimodal data. So they have roughly the same sigma, but different mu. So they're just shifted from each other. They have the same width, so they're pretty much the same areas, but they're shifted just a little bit. And so one is about 2 sigma away from the other. And then the next one's 2 sigma over, and the next one's 2 sigma over. And so that when you add those together into a single data set, you see something like this. So you see the 4 peaks I drew underneath this block of a histogram, and then it drops off sharply at the edge. Because all of these individual modes have a pretty narrow standard deviation. And so when you get past the last one, it drops off sharply. But when you're in the middle of them, they hand off from one distribution to the other to the other. You can see this in statistical data. You can also see this sometimes in spectral data or chromatography. You have multi-eluting peaks, 4 compounds coming out very close together. You see a sharp rise, a flat top, and then it drops out. You can also see this when you're saturating your detector. So the needle essentially is pegged, okay, and then it comes down. And so then that's actually a special cause because your detector doesn't have the dynamic range it needs. You need to dilute your sample because it's, the peak is hitting the upper limit and you're not getting any more signal. And so if you were to integrate the area of that peak and think it was related to concentration, it's not related to concentration because it was, and then now you're losing that signal that would have told you how much is there. If you saturate your detector, you cannot do quantitative analysis. So it's pegged to the needle. And during that whole time, you don't really know what the signal would have been. If the needle could go higher, you would have more signal to integrate. So you need to dilute your sample and cut it by a factor of 10. And rerun it. And then if you get the whole peak on there, you take into account the dilution factor. So you integrate that one peak and multiply by 10, and now you've got the full signal. Does that make sense? So this is just a couple of different ways your peaks can be non-Gaussian. The skewness, we talked a little bit about that. This is not very skewed data, the training data, but the you can see this is pretty close to one, but right here we have the forensic chemist. It's skewed to the right, 1.3 skewness value. And so here, yes?
I think you're up over it, but if it, the skewness is greater than one, then it's moving for shifting.
It's going to be tailed to the high side. Okay. And so these values that go down, the really small numbers, they're going to just keep trickling on over to the high side. If it's less than one, it'll be trickling over to the low side. So here we have, again, this one, I was saying greater than one, but this is, again, a positive and negative metric. So positive skewed data is skewed, we say to the right, because we typically plot low values to the left and high values to the right, but that's not always the case, as we saw from spectroscopy. Like in a Gaussian, in visible spectra, we plot the x-axis inverted. And so use the values, not the right or left. And so positive skew is tailing to high numbers. A negative skew is tailing to low numbers. So let's look at these two data sets. The assumption is they're plotting low values on the left, high values on the right. And you see this is going to be positively skewed. These small numbers that keep tailing out here to the right are tailed to high values. And so if it's skewed to high values, that's a positive skew. If it's skewed to low values, that's a negative skew. Now, there's typical cases for this. If you ever see anybody reporting salary data, like if a company's trying to get you to work for them, and they tell you the average salary in the company, you know they're manipulating the numbers, okay? Because salaries are almost always skewed to high values. What does that mean? Well, let's pretend this is salary data. Most of the people in the company are making this salary down here. A few people, the senior executives and the CEO, are making millions of dollars a year. Okay, well, there's not very many of them. But they're skewed to the high numbers. If you take the average, and you average every one of these equally weighted, then your average is gonna be over here somewhere. But what's the most probable salary? It's that one. Okay, and so whenever you're reporting data, you can just report. A lot of times people, and you know, I would say it depends on if they're conscious of it or not. If they're conscious of it or not, they're manipulating you. You know, if they're reporting the mean salary, the average salary on purpose to try to get you to feel like, oh, the mean salary is $80,000 a year. That sounds great, you know? But you get in there and you realize that the starting salary is 40. You know, the most probable salary is 60, but they told you 80. Well, because if you take into account the CEO's salary, it scoots that average up here. So if it's skewed high, it raises the average. And so they should tell you the median salary. The median salary is, if you sort every salary high to low, it's the very middle one. Okay. The very middle salary. So if you think about that, sort all of them high to low, The one that's halfway down is not going to be halfway down numerically. It's going to be halfway down in terms of order, high to low. And And so you're going to get down in here to the expected values. So the median is going to get rid of that skewed effect. Okay. The MP, or most probable value, is the one with the highest frequency. And whenever you're doing a histogram, this is a frequency chart. This is the number of salaries in that bin. That's the number of salaries in that bin. So the numbers, the salary numbers, are broken into little bins, little buckets. And you put, you know, if the first bucket has 100 employees in it, that's how tall that bar is. And if the next bucket has 300 employees, it's that one. 400, maybe 600. 600 employees make 60,000. And so that would be the most probable salary in this company. And that's going to be more reflective of what you could expect working for that company. It's sort of the most probable salary once you get past the introductory stage would be 60,000, as opposed to telling you the average salary, which would be 80,000, which fewer people get. Does that make sense? So that's where skewed data, if you hear salary data, you always want to listen for the median, not the mean, because salaries are always skewed high. There's a few people that make high salaries that shift the average to higher numbers. Failure lifetime data is often left skewed. So consider light bulbs. Very few will burn out right away, but those very few that have a lifetime of 1 month really drag the average down. And you want to know what's the expected lifetime, what's the most probable lifetime, what's the median lifetime, not necessarily what's the average lifetime. Okay. Now, if a company is trying to be conservative and report the worst case scenario, that's a situation where they may want to report the average lifetime. Because if you know anything about failure lifetimes, if the average is still 5 years, you say, hey, well, that's a pretty reliable product. Even with a few off failures, their average is still 5 years. Okay, but if their company is producing quite a few batteries that fail, then they would want to report the median, right? So that would be unaffected by these few that get out that fail in a month, and they can say the median lifetime is 5 years. So these are just some classic cases, salary data and lifetime data. Now, notice the skewness is just the asymmetry of the data. So both of these, even though they're crazy, well, this one actually is beautiful. This is a normally distributed thing. These would both show a zero skew because the left and the right is the same. But notice this one down here is crazy. It's not skewed. I have a skewness of zero, but look at that. Is it normally distributed? No, I have half the data on the left, half the data on the right. They happen to be the same magnitude, and that's why the skewness value would be zero. This is what's called a bimodal distribution, because I have one distribution on the right, one distribution on the left. This is not what we want to see if we're studying the results from two analysts in the lab. Right? One analyst says it's cocaine, the other one says it's not. We got a problem. Okay. And so bimodal data, you could have trimodal, but most of the time, if it's bigger than bimodal, you just say multimodal, like I did on the board here. This is clearly two different distributions. They happen, it's kind of tricky because they have the same mean. Okay, but there's two distributions, so there's two modes, bimodal data. This one, you have a whole bunch underneath that curve that we saw on the board, and so this is multimodal. And so sometimes the kurtosis number can give you an idea on if it's your data is multimodal or bimodal or single mode data. So let's look at our trainee and our forensic chemist. And what I wanted to do, this is another feature of the Minitab software. And this goes back to a training I was privileged to attend through Pantex. They wanted to improve the company's abilities to improve its processes. And so they took about 75 of us from all different divisions and sent us to what's called Six Sigma training. Fantastic opportunity. If you ever get a chance to do that, please do. It's not just related to engineering and manufacturing. We had people there from HR to streamline their policies. We had, you know, sort of office people as well. It wasn't just science and engineering. But they're looking at how to make processes lean. Like, if you're constantly being given paperwork to sign, but you really don't have the authority to make decisions on whether that process goes forward again, why do we care if you have a signature or not? Right? You're not doing anything. It's just something that you have to sign, but you're not engaging the mind. You're not making any decisions. It's just a bump in the road that people have to overcome when you go on vacation. Right? It slows things down if you're in the middle of a busy process and you really have no input to that process. And so this lean manufacturing and Six Sigma process analysis would come in and look and say, why are you involved in this approval chain if you're really not being asked to make any judgments? Right? You know, and so that's the thing. A lot of people want to have that authority just to sign, but they really aren't making any decisions based on their signature. And so they form teams and they say, why are we having these signatures? You know, if they're really not doing anything or adding anything to the process. That's just a simple example. A lot of times it's related to actual, you know, lab measurements. One of my projects was trying to control the balances in the lab way too tightly. So a technician would come in the morning and they put a 1 gram weight on the balance to see if the balance was behaving correctly. And if it was more than 0.0002 grams off, they said the balance needed to be recalibrated. Because that's what the box said. The box said the balance should be accurate to 0.0002 grams. First of all, that was probably just plus or minus one sigma. Okay? They weren't tying it to what they actually needed to weigh. So in their analysis with their dilutions and everything, they really only cared about the hundredths place. But they bought a four-place balance because that's an analytical balance. So they're trying to hold this balance to the fourth decimal place when all they really cared about was the second decimal place. And they were mistreating a really perfectly good balance by saying it's out of calibration when it's really not. So remember what plus or minus one sigma was. That was 0.63%, or around 64% of the Gaussian distribution. So just that balance operating perfectly is going to be outside plus or minus one sigma about 25-30%. Let's see, what is 0.6, let's say 0.64. So 26% of the time, it's going to, no, 36% of the time, it's going to be out of what they call out of calibration. And we actually saw those numbers. So the technicians were red tagging this balance and not doing any work all day, waiting for calibration folks to come over and to put a weight on and go, the balance is working fine, and take the tag off, and yet you've wasted 8 hours of a day and gotten no work done. Okay, so there's a little bit of that going on. But you know, you don't want to blame people for trying to just tag out. A lot of them were actually going to other balances and using them and actually getting some work done, but others were folding their arms and saying, I can't work, my balance is out of cal. And so what they did when they sent us to this training, they said, okay, they said, we've spent roughly $45,000 on this training for each of you. Now go back and save the company that kind of money. Okay. And this tag out thing, if added up, all the lost time over the year was well over that. It was like $48,000 saved by putting those people back to work. You know, and so it was incredible what this capability analysis, this statistical analysis of a process can do. And this is called capability analysis. So it doesn't just say we want the best standard deviation we can get. It actually analyzes what the specifications are. Now, we weren't given that in the book problem. We were just given the 10 analyses of cocaine by the trainee and by the forensic chemist. But the question you should ask as a manager is, how close are we to making a bad decision? Right? I give you this cocaine sample. Maybe it's cocaine, maybe it's not. At what percentage will you make the call? Yes, it's cocaine. And at what percentage, if you're below that, would you say, no, it's not? You see the question? That wasn't a part of that book question at all. How close are we to saying it's not a controlled substance? That's your specification limit.
95%?
Well, that's the confidence in the data. But this was 13.2% cocaine in this powder sample. How low does it have to be for you to say it's not cocaine? Do you follow me? So it's really going to be your quantitation limit. You know, do you detect it? You know, we're going to talk about those terms, the lower quantitation level. But let's just say, to pick a number, I pick 10%. Now, that's still kind of high, right? But anyway, let's just say for this capability analysis, that if it was less than 10% cocaine, we're going to say it's not substantially cocaine, so it's not a controlled substance. Okay? And so that would be our lower specification limit. So here it is at 10%. And remember, the trainee's average was pretty close to the true value. All right? It was. It came in at 12.87. So that was the average for the trainee. So it was well above 10%. But the standard deviation for the trainee was bad, wasn't it? They weren't very precise. They had that outlier at 15. And their data was pretty scattered. And if you look at the Gaussian distribution, the tail hits 10%. So even though they had a sample that was 13.2% cocaine, it should have been labeled as a controlled substance, there's a chance that they say it was not. In fact, this calculates what that chance is. And it would be parts per million less than the lower specification limit, 972 parts per million. Or 0.0009 chance that they would be below. So that sounds like it's a low value, but it's 0.09%. And that's not good, okay? If they did 1,000 cases, 9 of those would be above this, would be false negatives, okay? Or I'd say 10,000 cases, 9 of those would be below if they operated at this way the whole time. Let's look at the forensic chemist's capability analysis. Look what standard deviation would get you. Same specification limit, 10% cocaine. Their average was 13.27. The true value, the accepted value, was 13.2. But they had such a better precision that this drops to zero long before it gets to the specification limit. And in fact, they can't even calculate the parts per million that would be less than that. So in a million tests with something that had 13.2% cocaine in it, they would get zero false negatives out of a million. That's what you want. You're only 3% above the lower limit, and even at 3% above, you're never going to give a false negative. So that's great, and this is all, again, just a couple of clicks in Minitab. This will be a real pain to do in Excel. Okay, so really, mostly this is a commercial, not just for Minitab, but any statistical package. So when you get into the real world and you're analyzing your data, it's comfortable to do Excel. I beat Excel into you because everybody's going to have access to it. But there are better tools out there. There's more powerful tools. So ask to go to training. You know, whatever access software. Stat software your company has, ask to go to training on it so that you can be confident in its use. Okay. Very few bosses will be bothered by you asking for training. Right? And most of the time they're trying to get people to go to training. Yeah, because they want better trained people. And so if you're there saying, look, I found this stat package, I'm kind of fuzzy on it, can you send me to training? They're like, there's no money for that. And then you say, well, maybe next year. And I say, okay, I'll see what I can do. Next year you ask them again, they're like, okay, this person really wants to improve their skills. I really do need to find money for it, you know? And then the third year, they're like, yeah, you're persistent, you know? I'm gonna send you to training to get you out of my office. But then you start actually doing stuff with the training that you've received and you start to really shine, okay? As opposed to someone who's watching the clock, you know, and it 4:29, you're out the door, you know. And they come in and they're like, you know, you're not really using the stat pack. I thought about sending you to training. And you're like, I already got my bachelor's. What more do you want? You know, haven't I got enough in my head? You know, I guarantee if you have that attitude, they're waiting for a budget cut because you're going to be gone. It's real hard to fire somebody until the budget cuts come along, and then it becomes really easy. And if you're one of those folks who's trying to do the minimum, doesn't want to learn anymore because you learned enough, then guess what? They're going to send you back to Home Depot or wherever, you know. And you didn't get a bachelor's degree in chemistry to just get a job you could have gotten in high school. So let's look at just again some numbers. This is from some of my research. We did this analysis. Actually, I was really proud of my students. We had 24 measurements of contact angle on this part we thought was clean, and it was pretty clean. If it's a metal surface and this is a water drop, and if the water is in contact with that metal oxide surface, it will wet the surface. That's how we know a metal part is clean. You can put a water drop on it and it will suck down on the metal and have a low contact angle. The angle inside this water drop right here is the contact angle. And so I had, I think it was about six students measuring it, you know, four or five times a piece, 24. From the side with a little microscope, like a USB microscope. And so you just measure this angle here. And so this is the distribution of their data. It's very nice. It's a, you know, 80% chance of it being normal. So that's really good. And that's over four or five students. So they did really well. But the contact angle is 60 degrees. And so that's good. That's wetting. The water's wetting the surface. And so we said this is a clean surface. And then we took a silicone grease, like a vacuum grease, and slopped it all over the part. And boom, the contact angle went up. The water beat it up, okay? And so then they measured that. It was, again, because it was grossly contaminated, there was some grease and it was rough and it was hard to measure the contact angle. So we had some strange numbers, a little more bumpy, a little less normally distributed. And negative skew, you see how it shifts to the left a little bit? So the skewness comes out here. I'm just showing you this for real data. We're not really studying contact angle. But then we take this gross contamination, and it's on this aluminum disc, and we got the chem wipes, and we wiped it off, okay, with a dry wipe. And looked at it, you couldn't see any oil left or grease. We cleaned it with a dry wipe. We think the dry wipe would get most of the grease off. It got a lot. I mean, you can see it on the little chem wipe. And so you could look at that and say, well, that's a clean part. You put water on it? No, it's not. Okay, you see the water still beat it up. And you have an average of 103 degrees contact angle. So that's this angle inside, 103 degrees. Pretty tight standard deviation. Look, before our standard deviation was plus or minus 10 degrees. Now we're plus or minus 3. Yeah, exactly. So then we go back and we put some solvent in there. What we did actually is we put it in an ultrasonic bath. And so with a little bit of soap and water, put it in the ultrasonic bath, blew that grease right off. And now we're down, actually cleaner than we were before. So that was nice too, and again, pretty normal data. And so this is just a real world example where we use Winitab to analyze the parts. And let me just beat this drum for a little bit. So correlation does not imply causation. It's a new notes page. You don't have this, so definitely write this down. In fact, let me hear you say it out loud, just because I love that. Go ahead.
Correlation does not imply causation.
Okay, so what this means is correlation does not imply causation. All right? In other words, if one thing is correlated with the other, that does not mean that one caused the other.
Very important.
Yeah, very important principle in science.
In the real world.
Okay? Yeah. You're measuring correlations all the time. What we explore when we talk about a cause, you did this in organic chemistry, right? You put these two things in the pot, you cook them for a while, and two different things come out. That's correlated, okay? The mechanism is the thing that ties the reactants and products. Remember how much more difficult the mechanism was? Yes, I see nods, okay? Because the mechanism says this electrons go here, this bond gets weaker, acid comes along, steals it, whatever, a leaving group. These different things happen, and you have a mechanism for getting from the reactants to the products. Without a mechanism, you're really not showing how causation has occurred. Another term, a non-chemist term for mechanism is called the mode of action. So we've used mode twice. One time mode is used just sort of individual group of data, but in this case, a mode of action is sort of how this occurred. Like, they know that cholesterol is correlated with heart disease, okay, and heart attack. But is it causing it? No, they don't have a mode of action. Now, they do know that there's a mode of action for cholesterol creating plaque in the arteries. Okay, and so they're working on the mode of action, but early on, they just had a correlation. They just had a correlation of people with heart disease and heart attack risk had high cholesterol. That's just a correlation. Okay. And so in order to drive this home, you can look at correlations that are obviously not connected. Now, I know you may be saying, well, how do you know they're not connected, right? It's a very bold claim to claim a negative, right? You're saying this is not connected to that. There may be some crazy way that you can't think of that this is connected to that, because there's such a high correlation. But trust me, okay, go to Tyler Vegan's page and look at spurious correlations. Here's a couple of them. U.S. spending on science, space, and technology is correlated with suicides by hanging, strangulation, and suffocation. Oh. Look at that!
I don't
okay,
like it.
The black dots are hangings by suicide, and the red dots are U.S. spending on science.
Spending's going up, though. That's good.
It's interesting. And so the cool thing is that correlation does not imply causation. You know, I'm pretty confident to say that spending on science is not causing suicides.
Yeah.
Now, these two things might be connected to something that is connected. Okay, it's kind of like the Kevin Bacon game, you know, with the movies. Anyway, this divorce rate in Maine, per capita consumption of margarine. Probably not connected.
Oh, that's connected.
Definitely correlated. Yeah. Oh, I can see that one.
That one actually.
Butter, not margarine.
Yeah, so this one doesn't show the R value. So let me go back and go to the actual site here where you see the R values. Okay, this one with the science and technology and strangulation and suffocation, the correlation is 99.79%.
Dear Lord.
Wait, what's next?
Is that crazy? So I don't care if it's 99% correlated. You can be confident they're correlated, right? But you don't necessarily know if they're connected. Okay, so it's just one of those things to say there's lies, there's damn lies, and there's statistics. So you can play games with statistics and really get people wound up very easily, but correlation does not imply causation.
Can we see the next one?
Can we see the next one?
Look at that. Number of people who drowned by falling into a pool and films Nicolas Cage appeared in. 66% correlated, but still, look at that.
Nice.
Even the highs and lows.
You really should make less films than
that.
He should make less films, I think.
Who gets tangled in their bed sheets? Well,
they died.
Over 600 people.
What is going on?
Yeah, so this is a good one, too.
They die.
If you eat cheese, you're going to get tangled in your bed sheets and die. Yeah.
Well, I don't eat cheese, so I think I'm safe from
there
that
one. There you go, right? Yeah. Thank God you're lactose intolerant, right?
Oh my gosh.
Oh, wait.
Miss America and murders by steam, hot vapors, and hot objects.
You know, that one seems, it's higher correlation than the other one.
87%.
Yeah, it's higher.
Yeah, so, there you go.
That one could be problematic.
They do choose some really crazy ones.
They do. It's so funny. I don't know where this guy got his data. When his source
yes.
is
yes.
Yes. Arcades and doctors. Right.
There we go.
Oh,
well. Everyone go to arcades. You get a degree.
Anyway, 98%. Sociology doctorates in commercial space.
Interesting.
That is a
really
weird one.
Yeah, mozzarella cheese and engineering doctorates.
It's from the Wisconsin civil engineers.
Wow.
Marriage rate in Kentucky and drowning.
Yeah, I can see that.
And that one, you know, that passes the 95% test. That's
horrible.
That's greater than 95% correlated. So.
But that one's true though. That one's
yeah.
True.
You know, this is a defense lawyer's
wow.
dream.
We gotta leave Norway alone, yeah. I think.
Crude oil and chickens. Nuclear power plants and swimming pools.
Those nuclear power plants in there, people making brownies and stuff like that.
Yes.
Wow. Okay, that's
yeah.
Cool.
Other than this one, letters in the winning word of the Scripps National Spelling Bee.
We need to stop those spelling bees.
What is this?
That's kind of
that probably wins the weirdness factor.
I don't know that. The Nick Cage one.
I know the Nick Cage one was
yeah,
pretty good.
The Nick Cage one, I mean.
Or the bedsheet one. That was pretty good.
Anyway, this is a book. If you want a really weird coffee table book, you know, for when you have your own house and stuff.
I might buy that book.
Yeah.
It's hilarious.
I'm definitely going to buy that.
I'll buy the book. Give weird facts to people.
Yeah. Okay, so let's take a minute. Here we go. Let's start.
Oh, stretching.
Yeah. Four questions.
Nick Cage.
Yes. Okay, this distribution of income, you see, is normally distributed, is exhibiting negative kurtosis, is skewed right to high values, skewed left to low values. And these two are big because they say greater than or whatever, and so then it's like, yeah, so they just extended it out, so anything greater than this, and so there's a big bump. Yay, skewed to high values in income, you know, in all companies I've ever seen skewed that way. This distribution of otter hound deaths, which I don't even know what an otter hound is bimodal, skewed to the left to low values, and it's plotted low to high, left to right. Skewed right to high values, normally distributed. Okay, this one actually has two correct answers. It's bimodal and it's skewed left. So let's look at it again. You see this bump?
Yeah. Okay.
That's a second mode. It's a second little mini distribution. Okay, so you've got the first mode, the second mode, and it's skewed left. So if you were to describing this, you would say it's skewed to the left and there's two modes. There's two groups. You might look at this and say, oh wow, that's our middle management. You know, we've got a lot of employees with different levels of experience, and then we've got a little bump for people who are managing people. I mean, this is debts.
Yeah.
It's a salary thing. So, this is the normal lifetime of otter hounds.
When something happened.
Maybe there was an epidemic.
For yeah.
You know, people. 15 years, right?
Yeah, so this is the short-lived one.
It's a dog, by the way.
Thank you. I figured with the hound part, but I've never seen one that I know of. Yeah. Okay, the forensic chemist's results were not normally distributed, so their work should be suspect. True or false? So the forensic chemist's results were not normally distributed, so their work should be suspect. False. Right? It doesn't mean that there's a problem, okay? It just means that there wasn't enough, they didn't run the samples enough to get that distribution. You just haven't detected the normal distribution in your data. It was only 10 measurements. Okay. U.S. spending of science correlates with suicide by hanging.
So
true,
what?
True, false, so what?
So what? It's all right. It's okay.
You can see the trends there.
I was waking up my screen.
Yeah, the two-thirds chance.
Wait, you got, wait a second.
Yeah.
Come on,
yeah. So what and true. It correlates.
It correlates,
so
yes.
What, yeah. So with Kahoot, sorry, you get to pick one or the other. You know.
I don't know, I was accidentally saying the right answer.
And why can we say, so
twice
what?
And it's hit
because
the
correlation is not implied causation.
Both of the times
they were wrong.